The Night Owl Show, next on Channel 6 in Woodstock.
Attention, attention. This is an official civil defense warning. This is not a test. The United States is under nuclear attack. Take cover immediately in your area of fallout shelter. Repeat, the United States is under nuclear attack. Take cover immediately in your area of fallout shelter.
By all means, provide some tranquilizers to ease the strain and monotony of life in a shelter. A bottle of 100 should be adequate for a family of four. Tranquilizers are not a narcotic and are not habit-forming.
Civil defense information will be broadcast in most areas at 6:40 or 12:40 on your
attention,
regular
attention.
Radio receiver.
This is an official civil defense warning. This is not a test. The United States is under nuclear attack. Take cover immediately in your area fallout shelter.
Now, children, I want you to sit down here against the wall. That's it. Now, crouch tight up against it.
Now listen, kids. If they're dropping an atomic bomb, it may go off any second now. Whatever happens, I'll give the signal when it's all right for us to get up. If there's an explosion, we'll wait about a minute after it's all over. Then we'll go upstairs and take a look around, see if it's all right for us to clean up.
Country.
What we're dealing with is the making and processing of a radioactive uranium-based metal. And along with that, you know, we use some pretty hazardous gases and chemicals.
And they send these billets off and get them extruded down to rods to where they're about an inch and a half in diameter and about 10 foot long, and they ship them back here to where we take them and more or less chop them up and make them into what you call penetrators for the government's defense, which they use to pierce tanks and stuff with that. Well, we seen a movie one time where they shot one in it through a 3-inch piece of metal and it burned a hole. I mean, you know, big old size like this just burns it up.
If it was an unhazardous place, it wouldn't be no way that I could be out here on strike for, you know, the money. But this is a steal at the money they're offering us right now. It's the lowest paid nuclear plant in the United States. And it's the highest paid industry in the United States. But the money ain't our factor. The main factor is health and safety. My life is worth more than $7.20 an hour. Jonesboro right now, 4 years ago, they really, you know, discovered that it was a historical town. It's the oldest town in the state of Tennessee. And these people from all over the country, all over the United States, come and visit this place around the 4th of July. They have a celebration then. And, you know, people that comes in, I'm sure there's a lot of them concerned about radiation because in their town, there's probably radiation there. But they don't really, you know, realize there's radiation right in the historical town of Jonesboro. But it ain't something like a mile and a half, maybe 2 miles up the road. And radiation does travel for several hundreds of miles. And there is radiation in Jonesboro, especially in historical Jonesboro days, when they have them every year. And people ain't realize they breathe it, but they do. And, you know, the community, they really should get concerned about this. But they don't. They don't care whether they live or die, I don't guess.
Every day when I went home, I had this black stuff all over me, and it was the oxide from the crucibles. And we had to take a shower every day, but the shower didn't get that black off of you. It was in your hands and on your feet, even on your underclothes and your skin. You couldn't get it off. So you just took it home with you every day and brought it back to work the next day, and it was full of radiation. So, and most of the time when I worked 1 week on my job, and then my count would be so high that the next week I would have to mop all week. So that's how bad it is. That's how bad the radiation is in there. It's rough.
How did they monitor you? Do you know how much radiation exposure you had?
Not at the time, but since we went on strike, we requested our medical records, and we know how high they are now.
And how high was your...
I don't remember exactly all of mine, but some of the other boys was a whole lot higher than mine. Because, see, I just worked 3 months before I got hurt bad. And, you know, some of the boys, their counts have been way up there, 2,000 or 3,000. And Dr. Mark Nelson says that is bad, because anytime you get over 30, it's a high count.
Well, I found some of your records, and
oh, good. After all this time, I'll find out what they mean.
All right, this refers to the millirem of radiation you've been exposed to. We measure radiation.
Oh, there's the seminar record. I've never got to see it.
Right. And
here I am.
You're also here, right?
Yeah.
Okay. One X-ray to your chest is equivalent of about 20 millirems worth of radiation. And you've got high levels here. You have like 47 millirem on Monday, 69 millirem on
Tuesday.
That's
a low week, though. Do you have any that go back further than that?
Well, you got 104 millirem on Thursday. That's the equivalent of about 5 chest x-rays to your whole body. If that's a low week, I'd be scared to see the higher numbers.
We used to have contests to see who was going to be the highest at the end of the day.
That's a lot of radiation. You got 80 millirem on Tuesday that week, and 35 on Wednesday, and 80 on Thursday. I mean, these are outrageous levels. I don't mean to say I know you're going to have health effects because of this, but you have an increased risk. All the workers in this plant, if these levels continue, run increased risk of diseases, you know, due to these radiation exposures. That we do know.
We have a lot of blowouts on those big pots where they make the big derbies. And when we first used to have those, the whole shop would fill with smoke. You know, this is where the uranium was melted into the derby. And they used to make us, you know, get out, you know, go take a long break. And after that, they wouldn't let us leave.
You couldn't even see your buddy standing 5 foot from you. Smoke would be so thick. You couldn't even see your buddy standing right over front. It'd be so thick.
And after that, you know, you weren't allowed to leave.
They'd make you stay in there when the smoke was all over.
No respirator on.
Unless you just went and hid you somewhere.
Well, it sounds like they want to keep production going and sacrifice people's health.
That's it. They want to come in here with their big money and go back to California and don't live in this area. They don't live around where these water streams is at. They live out in California, and they won't come in here and pollute our air, pollute our water, pollute our bodies. And then they go back out there in California and eat like a big queen king, you know. And while we're down here breathing all this stuff that they brought in here on us, and they're making a profit off of it. That's what they want to do.
They were telling me all along, everyone was told, or it was just, you know, common belief that we were working in depleted uranium, that it was a low-level radiation. It was nothing like nuclear fuels in Irwin, that they worked with, 95% pure uranium and all this, that we were not exposed to anything like that. It's nothing to worry about until I popped up pregnant, and then they just fell all to pieces. It was just as if they had been covering up a lie all that time, telling everybody that exposures was nothing to worry about. And then when that happened, they found out that, well, they've just got something on their hands and they didn't know how to deal with it. They couldn't lay me off even if they wanted to. My doctors told me, you can work, girl, till 2 weeks before your delivery date. They said they wanted me moved off the furnaces.
even though you could still do the work.
Yeah. Oh, I was able to do the work. I did the work for 2 months. I didn't even know I was pregnant. As far as the lifting and the exposure to temperatures and those stories like that and having to bend, I do that much out there in that garden.
I run a grinder, and all them fumes and stuff comes right back in your face off them machines. And my count's been up numerous times. And
you know, sure
I've had two or three exposures over 260 from my urine count and my badge. And one time I believe it was 280, and they took a resample, and it was down to 12. So you can,
I like it.
You can explain that, you know.
Yeah, they did.
From the same sample.
From the same samples. Yeah. My back starts hurting because, you know, I've had kidney trouble before. I've had a kidney stone operation, and it bothers me, you know, because this goes right to your kidneys first place. It goes, you know, because it goes through your urinary tract, and it gets me scared, you know, when my kidneys start bothering me.
My back hurt me real bad. I mean, it just constantly throbbed around my kidney area. And for one instant during Christmas, I thought it was the flu I had. And it turned out to be when I was real sick during that vacation. We company laid, you know, give us a little vacation there, 2 or 3 days, I don't remember how long. But I mean, I thought I had to come down with the flu. But what it was, when I went back, they said, you've had a high count. And I asked them how high. They said 1,950. You know, and they set limits down to their own of 100. So then when they said 20 times higher, I figured, well, the limit had to be around 100. So they sent me to a kidney specialist. And I went up there, and he allowed, you know, run some tests on me, and I believe he took some blood and stuff like that. And I never did hear no results from him, but he told me that radiation could cause kidney damage and failure. And he showed me them kidney machines over people had to sit on. I didn't quite like that too well. So when I went back to the plant, I asked him, what can you do about this? And they said, there's nothing we can do about it. But Jim Barlow, he said, there's one thing you can do about it for yourself. And I asked him, what was that? He said, drink more beer. Drink beer every day. He says, I wish I could put in company policy that everybody here drink beer. So flush the radiation out of your kidneys. When we first went on a strike, I suffered like withdrawal symptoms, I was telling you earlier. But I had to wear my back brace for a while, didn't I, Nancy? Mm-hmm. My back really hurt me. When I went out to cut them locust posts, it was all I could do just to get around. And I kept that brace on. I take that brace off, felt like my kidneys were gonna poke out. But you know, now I had to work that out of my system. It seemed like it was something that lingered in my system. I had to work it out. Just like I reckon anything else, but it just took a while. And I'm sure I've still got some in there. They say it never leaves you. When you die and you're in your little box, it'll be a little speck or radioactive. They say nuclear worker.
Citizen, he wants to talk to you all.
Okay.
Right over here in that green truck. See what a green truck is?
Yeah.
He lives in that house right there.
Oh, yeah?
He wants to talk to you all.
All right. We'll finish up here. We'll go be glad.
Oh, God.
To crawl into like Bert the Turtle, so we have to cover up in our own way. Paul and Patty know this. No matter where they go or what they do, they always try to remember what to do if the atom bomb explodes right then. It's a bomb, duck and cover. We must be ready every day, all the time, to do the right thing if the atomic bomb explodes. Duck and cover. That's the first thing to do. Duck and cover. First, you duck. And then, you cover. You duck and cover tight. Duck and cover under the table. It's a bomb. Duck and cover. 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 Duck and cover yourself. Duck and cover. Duck and cover. Duck and cover.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You
and you
and you
and you
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 duck
and cover.
Remember what to do, friends. Now tell me right out loud. What are you supposed to do when you see the flash?
Glad to catch you out playing here. Oh. I brought the latest word.
I have quite a few things to report on this week, but I'll just report on one because I think it's important. I wrote it up in the Woodstock Times in a letter to the editors, and here's the clipping that a friend of mine sent me from the Friedman. And very interestingly enough, a young lady by the name of Modell Clark did a little bit, and of course, photo by Alan Carey, and it says on the top, Salvador atrocities go untold. Now, Dr. Lear spoke down at New Paltz, and he spoke to a small group, and he mentioned that he had spoken before 25 or more reporters in Washington, D.C., when he came back announcing the atrocities in El Salvador, which I believe was 9 doctors, 7 medical students, and 1 nurse were all assassinated by the military junta. Their hit squads come in and wipe them out. In fact, there was some mention that some of the doctors died in the operating room. They came in and wiped out everybody that was there. Of course, they don't mention patients because they're only worried about doctors being killed. However, the fact that this did not receive any press coverage at all with 25 reporters disturbed him, and he went on to New York City where he got more than 30 reporters. Now, New York City has some pretty heavy newspapers, the Times, the News, the Wall Street Journal, some of the biggest papers in the world. Not a word was mentioned the next day because, as I said, United Press, Associated Press International, New York Times, they are all suppressed. Our Central Intelligence Agency is in there and cuts out all the words. So here we have this whole thing mentioned in none other than the Kingston Freeman and the Woodstock Times. And my word on the CIA, I think I mentioned before, comes from Bernstein of Woodworth and Bernstein, all the president's men. And he made this statement in an article which I read the original of, and it was edited and put in the Rolling Stone. There are over 400 CIA men in the media. And that's why you never get the truth out of what you think. The normal TV and the normal newspapers should print some of the truth, something that's going on.
Do you think our little TV station here is abnormal?
Yes, you're slightly abnormal. In Woodstock, various things happen. And this is midnight in Woodstock, and how many Woodstockers that, if they are up this late, are usually out partying, and it's only a few that would be on the wire. And to you wonderful people that are here watching, I thought I'd let you know. And if you'd like to do something about it, I think it would be really a good idea to mention it. It's worth mentioning to your congressman that there is a suppression of the press in the United States. So I just thought I'd let you know that this week, that this is a suppression of the press week. We have very exciting news for next week if we talk next week. because other things are coming through, but I don't want to clog it. Just remember that this really happened. Salvador atrocities go untold because our military gang wants to generate a little war down in El Salvador. And of course, we're backing the main bad guys, and we want to do that because we are now bad guys in the world. The United States are crumbs. They're liars, they're murderers, they're assassins, and they are no longer the nice sort of people we pretend to be. They go to church on Sunday and are join the Boy Scouts.
What do you think of the neutron bomb business?
That's another bit of a silly disaster, because the neutron bomb will be even worse and dirtier, I'm sure, than the standard bomb. That's its effect is the dirty effect, the killing of life. And, of course, the continually rising cancer figures, no one wants to mention that the atomic power has anything to do with this. But we do know that atomic power is being pushed by the military for their own uses, and we, the people, are suffering from it. The death rates and the warped mentalities of little kids and bodies and lowering of the IQ rates all around the nuclear plants. But basically, here is freedom of the press. Now, you are the press. I think you should be impressed by this and should do something about it. Evidently, they can't stop the Woodstock night owls. So night owls, if that's enough to stir you up for the week, I hope you think about it and do something between next week. Report back to me by next week. Otherwise, I'll flunk you all in the night owl class. Okay, Night Owls, I'll see you later. I gotta go back to more secret information.
Santa, cheer up. Things can't be all that bad. Let's get into the Christmas spirit. Shall we sing a Christmas song?
I don't know, LG.
Well, that's the way I feel. I don't know about singing either. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll put some Christmas songs on the jukebox, and that should cheer us both up. There's Santa Claus. Doesn't that song make you feel better? Doesn't that put you in a Christmas spirit?
It's true. I do like Brenda Lee.
That's right. That'll make you feel much better.
Deck those with boughs of holly.
Fit to be a happy heart.
That's it, Santa Claus. Keep going. I think you're doing great. I know before too much longer, I'll tell you what we'll do. Have a drink with me for Christmas, and I know that'll make you feel much better and help you put you in the spirit of things. Something really good. That's a good imported Canadian whiskey called Black Velvet.
Christmas spirit.
Christmas spirit. Plenty of it. Guaranteed to set you right off. Look at Santa.
Put her there, LJ.
Okay, Santa. I guarantee you'll find everybody at home by now.
This is Channel 6 in Woodstock. Channel 6 concludes its programming day with our national anthem.